Madam Vice Rector, Madam Ambassador, Mr. Ambassador, ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, of course, after such distinguished speakers, it's not very easy to say something interesting and to close the session. And of course, we reached philosophical heights with the French ambassador talking about security and Renan and Brodel and Malthus, and so it's not really very easy to sort of to reach that level of height of philosophical. And you know, the French have been very good at philosophy anyway, historically, so I'm not going to compete with the ambassador. Instead, I'm trying to give you some hints how my country, Hungary, is contributing to European stability and stability in the neighborhood, the security in the neighborhood. You know, recently many things has been said about Hungary in the European press, and mostly negative, how we are behaving badly and we are not abiding by European norms and all that. I'm not going to counter that because it's not my job, because I'm not the spokesperson for the Hungarian Foreign Minister or Hungarian government. Instead, I give you some concrete ideas how we are contributing to the stability and security of the neighborhood and of Europe. And I will make 4 points. The first point is that my country is contributing to security and stability in the neighborhood and in the global era, global scenery or global scene, maybe more than our size of our population or our territory. That's the first statement. The second statement, on the record, Hungary has been a firm supporter of enlargement and neighborhood policy. That's my second point. These are two sort of philosophical points, if you like. And the third point will be our position in the eastern neighborhood, and the fourth will be our position in the southern neighborhood of the European Union. So these are the 4 points I would like to address. Number one point was that Hungary is contributing more than her size in global politics to stability and security in the neighborhood in global politics. And I will give you some numbers and some concrete data to support my statement. Not many people know that Hungary is deploying around 1,000 troops in various missions all over the world, whether it's European Union, whether it's United Nations, whether it's NATO. We have got soldiers all over the place, in the Western Balkans, in, you know, in Central African Republic, in Mali, in Somalia, in Cyprus, in Kurdistan. So I mean, I could go and on, but I'm just trying to say that us, being a small country, even NATO member, we are doing our share to stabilize the neighborhood, to stabilize hotspots in global politics. I mean, you know, we've got very nice lists about our contributions to various places, but I think that considering the size of my country, 1,000 troops is a very big number. I mean, if you have put together a list of countries and numbers, and of course France is a big country with a very, you know, long history of sending troops abroad and, you know, trying to contribute stability in Africa or other places. But, you know, we are doing very well. That's my point. That's the first proof I'm using to strengthen my point. Second one is that Hungary is not the most, not the richest member of the European Union. We are benefiting nicely and handsomely from European cohesion funds, but we are still spending quite a lot of money on international development. Aid money, basically, for Africa, Asia, poor parts of the world, the third world, if you like. I give you just two data, which is quite interesting. In 2010, when Orban government came to power, second Orban government, Hungary has spent about 24 billion forints on international development, maybe 5-6 years ago. Last year, the same number was roughly 44 billion USD, billion forints. So basically, this number tells you that in 5 years, we have nearly doubled. We have nearly doubled our share of international development. And obviously, most of the things are going through the European Union. We are donating to the EU-Turkey deal according to our size of the GDP. We are contributing to the European Union Syria Trust Fund, also the Africa Trust Fund, various places. And within the V4 and nationally, we are contributing to the Ukraine's development. So I got the numbers in place, and Ambassador knows about it. So, but I would like to say that, considering the size of the Hungarian economy, we are contributing quite handsomely to, you know, international development. So put these two factors together, troop deployment and international development, my argument would be that we are contributing, we are stabilizing in the neighborhood, and we are playing our role as a country, a NATO member, giving something, contributions to global security. That's the first point I wanted to make. Second point, on the record, since we joined the European Union in 2004, we have been always big fan of enlargement and also Eastern Partnership, Eastern European Partnership. We believe that the EU accession of Western Balkan states, Serbia, Macedonia, Albania, Montenegro, it's unfinished business. The European Union has promised these countries in 2003, Thessaloniki, European perspectives. Talks are going on, and our line or position is that these talks should be finished, completed. Of course, conditions should be met by all these countries, but there is no reason why we shouldn't enlarge to these countries if these countries abide by the terms of the accession treaty or accession procedures. Of course, when one reads about Brussels, there is enlargement fatigue. It's part of the game. Mr. Juncker famously said that there won't be any enlargement throughout his term until 2020. Well, it's also part of the story, but I'm just saying that in this balance of power, my country is contributing and supporting enlargement. For these reasons, we were quite happy when Montenegro got NATO membership in December, last December. If you have a look at the news, the Hungarian ambassador in Montenegro was one of the major forces beyond helping Montenegro reaching the NATO membership. Coming back to Eastern European politics, or Eastern Partnership, Eastern Neighborhood Partnership, it was started by Sweden and Poland in 2008. From the beginning, my country has been a supporter. We believe that these countries, we should do our utmost to get these countries closer to Europe, including Ukraine, of course. And for this reason, we and my prime minister, not long ago, said that Ukraine has done her lessons to fulfill the conditions of visa-free travel. And if they did that, why are we not giving Ukraine a visa-free travel to Europe? It's being discussed in Brussels. The Commission said that Ukraine has fulfilled all the conditions, same for Georgia. And we believe that this is our this is a credibility problem for the European Union. If we are not doing that, we are losing our credibility. These countries have done their jobs, so we have to give them what they are promised. Free trade. Hungary was very one of the first countries to ratify the CFTA, the free trade agreements with these countries. And now we've got a bit of a problem with the Dutch processes and the referendum. We are asking the Dutch government to do their jobs to ratify DCFTA in Ukraine and with Georgia as soon as possible. And for these reasons, some of our parliamentarians have sent a letter to The Hague this week, maybe yesterday, the ambassador was about it, asking for speeding up the process of ratification. They have to get the help of the Commission, and hopefully by the December European Council, the European Union will be able to pass a very positive message, ratify and start implementing the DCFTA with Ukraine. So these were the sort of two principles of our neighborhood policy. One is on development and security policy, deploying troops in various missions. Second was about Eastern Partnership. And now I'm shifting to Eastern Partnership as a sort of geographical area. I mean, there are six countries to be mentioned here, and I will say one or two sentences about each country. I started Ukraine because this is the biggest and most important countries. Hungary stands ready and always has stood ready to support Ukraine's territorial integrity. That's why we are part of the sanctions regime, and we have always voted for that, in spite of the economic losses with Russia, what you heard us saying before, but this is very important. Second one to say here is that Normandy format with the French and German and Ukrainian Russian leaders is the only format at the moment which can deliver a negotiated settlement of the Donbas conflict. We wholeheartedly accept and thank Germany, France for their leadership on this. We had the ambassador a couple of weeks ago in our office, Mr. Benko, and we had this discussion on Ukraine and Russia and France. We support the Normandy process, and we hope that after the summit in Berlin, the promised roadmap will be implemented, because there is no other game show in town, only the Normandy format. I talked about DCFTA free trade, I talked about visa-free travel, so I'm not going to repeat that. And the last sentence is that we commend the reforms Ukraine have been doing so far. What we need is more of it in order to modernize the country. And we heard the reasons from the ambassador why they are trying to come as close to Europe as possible. I think that they have done a good job so far. We commend that, but you know, you should go further on that road. And you know the whole story. I'm not going to go into details, but I think that the best way of safeguarding Ukrainian sovereignty and identity is to go on with the reforms. This is what we see. And us, Hungary bilaterally, and in Visegrad 4, we have been trying to help Ukraine with these processes, with technical advice, with aid, and that's very important. Georgia, second leading country, they had just an election in Tbilisi, free and fair elections in the neighborhood is always welcome. This is what happened in Georgia. A new government is being formed. We have to give the same to Georgia, DCFT and free travel, and we have to commend the new Georgian democracy that they were able to deliver a free and fair elections. Number two, Moldova, Republic of Moldova, they are in the middle of the election campaign. We had the first round. What we can say at the moment is that we are hoping that the second round is democratic, fair and free, and it will produce a new president of the republic, and Georgia will Moldova will continue her way on European integration. There are three other countries which haven't been mentioned here: Armenia, Azerbaijan, and Belarus. Just one sentence on each of them. We are working with the Azeris to have a negotiated treaty with them. It's not a membership treaty, it's just some kind of agreement in between. Azerbaijan is very important for their role in regional security and, of course, energy providing. If the Southern Corridor goes ahead, Europe will be able to tap into Azeri and later maybe Azerbaijan, Turkmen gas. We shall see that, but that's very important. Belarus is very close to Russia, we know that, but we have to appreciate that they have done some good jobs, and we have to take President Lukashenko seriously when he says that he wants to diversify his foreign policy toolbox. Hungary was a big supporter of opening up to Minsk and abolishing the sanctions. I think that a very cautious opening is happening in Belarus, and the European Union have to help this. Armenia is part of the Eurasian community. They have got their special role. Armenia is an old Christian country, it's very important to Europe, and we are also having a discussion with them, a treaty-based relationship. This is so much about Eastern Partnership, and maybe I've got 2 minutes for the Southern neighborhood. Obviously, Syria is the most painful aspect of the Southern neighborhood. I don't have to tell you the linkage between migration and the conflict in Syria and Iraq. What we are seeing in Aleppo is really horrific. The European Union has passed text and decisions on Syria in the FAC and the European Council in the last couple of weeks. Hungary is a European Union member, because we are sticking with this. And I think the most important challenge is to get a ceasefire and to get aid into Aleppo and try to avoid bloodshed. We are not yet there. Us, Europe, US, Russia, regional powers, we have to negotiate and try to get something out of this. Well, it's to be seen if we are going ahead or not, but this is really terrible. In addition to Aleppo, we are seeing the Mosul battle, in which Iraqi government forces supported by the Western Alliance is sort of clearing up ISIL-Daesh from Mosul. It's also very difficult scenery, but we say that without stabilization of Iraq and Syria, this is no way to stop migration from that part of the world. And you heard my Prime Minister saying many times that we have to send help where it's needed. So in order to stop or slow down, stem the flow of migration, we have to help these countries. That's why we are having 150 Hungarian troops in Kurdistan, in Erbil, training the Peshmerga fighters. I think this is a very important mission in which, as I said, we are contributing to global security. Libya is also a very sensitive issue, obviously. Failed state, no central government, no limits to migration. The same story, in a sense, that the failed state of Syria and Iraq, and it will take obviously a long time to have a negotiated settlement in all of these countries, but we have no other choice but first stop the conflict, then try to have negotiated settlement. For many reasons, stability of the southern neighborhood and also stop migration, because migration is having a very bad impact on European infrastructure and architecture, as you read in the news. And last sentence is Iran. I believe that Europe 3 plus 3 negotiations with Iran were very successful. We managed to have an agreement last summer, and obviously the implementation is not very easy, but it's going ahead. And I think that it showed that preventive diplomacy or diplomacy can work if there is political will for this. And in that, I think the European Union managed to have a diplomatic success. It's quite rare that the European Union is having diplomatic successes, but the Iranian talks, it's one of those dossiers where the European Union managed to achieve something. Obviously, it's to be seen if it's going to be implemented fully and how Iran will play in the neighborhood. It's a long discussion. Maybe next conference we can talk Iran and regional stability, you know, Shiites versus Saudis and all that. It's very interesting topics for students with international relations and scholars and researchers. I can tell you that on my daily work, I'm spending quite a lot of time on regional conflicts in the Middle East, not only Iran, but Palestinian-Israeli conflict and all that. But of course, there is a lot of room for research in those areas, and I expect and I urge all the colleagues present at this conference to go under the skin of the problems and try to have nice and clever academic papers which might help us to understand better faraway parts of the world, whether it's in Eastern Partnership or Eastern neighborhood or Southern neighborhood. Thank you very much indeed.